Hello everyone, myself Priscilla. This is a new initiative brought to you by Transform IAS Academy. In this, we will be detailing the current affairs on a daily basis related to UPSC and KPSC exam. So let's get started for 9-7-2018, the Hindu analysis. The first news item, 9 parties oppose a proposal for simultaneous elections. So we have the political parties were actually divided on the issue of holding a simultaneous elections to the Lok Sabha and also for the State Legislative Assembly during the consultation with the Law Commission of India. So we know that this is a proposal which has been coming from the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and he wanted to have a simultaneous elections for the Lok Sabha and the Legislative Assemblies. Taking this into consideration, the Law Commission had done a consultation to what has to be done further, and there are 9 parties which have expressed the reservations, whereas 4 parties which actually supported the move for having a simultaneous elections. The 2 major national parties, that's BJP and Congress, had stayed away from the consultations. They have not made a statement regarding to it. And we have the small parties, Dravida Munnetra Kalgam, we have the Janata Dal, Aam Aadmi Party, which have strongly opposed to simultaneous elections and also argued that this particular move is against the basic tenets of the constitution. And we had the Telugu Desam Party, which said that one nation, one poll, which is a very good idea. But if at all we have to look on for an incompatibility with the constitution and also look on for an impracticable. So is it really practicable in the present situation? So what would be the actual problems? So here this is one of the statements from the TDP. Then we have the DMK again, Mr. Stalin, the working president out there. So he had sent forth a letter telling that the working paper does not seem to have considered that the Lok Sabha is also capable of being dissolved before its 5-year term. And if a situation were to happen, it is unclear whether all the legislative assembly will also be dissolved to synchronize the electoral process again. So for example, we have the Karnataka state which has held with an election recently. And now if this move happens in the year 2019, we have the Lok Sabha elections. So if the Lok Sabha elections happens in 2019 for the present particular kind of an elections which has happened in the year 2018 in Karnataka, will it have a re-elections again? So if that's the case, what would be the reasons or what would be the problem pertaining to the center and also the states which have completed with the electoral processes, and which means that they should start the electoral processes again? So how well is this going to work out? So how is the dissolving procedure going to work? How is that we need to synchronize the electoral process is one of the letter which is being brought by the DMK working president. And they also tell that in a federal democracy, you cannot think of having a simultaneous elections because this is something you have to look on first and foremost for a poll reform. How is that we need to go ahead with it? By putting a seal on the expenditure, but no one's talking about it. And this was one of the statements which has been coming from Mr. JDS leader, Danish Hali, which tells that no one are thinking about the expenditure which would be incurred by having an elections. So these are the important, and he also added that the proposal was aimed against smaller regional players. So this is one of the statements which has been coming from the JDS leader. So this is how it's like being said here. We have like 9 parties which have given a proper opposition, and only the 4 parties have supported the particular move. So here you have the mixed signal. So for whatever the division of the houses that happened with respect to the simultaneous elections. So here we have the BJP as a written stating that it will give a detailed response later. So it's been stayed away right now. They're not making any statements on it. Then we have the General Secretary Sitaram, who wrote the Law Commission on Friday to oppose the idea. So this is CPI, General Secretary is telling that you have to oppose the idea. And we have responses yet to come from Congress, BJP, RJD, BSP and the JDU. And we have support. So I said there are 4 important areas which has been supporting all the party members. One is TRS, then we have the Shiromani Akali Dal. Then we have the AIADMK and the SP. So these are the 4 parties which is in support to the simultaneous elections, and the opposed parties are here. So this is about it. The next news item, the fish samples test positive for formalin. So basically here we have the fish industry experts which are telling that the formalin or the formalin is sprayed on the fish or injected into the fish, or the fish is dipped into the solution. This keeps the fish fresh for a long time. So the main work or outcome of the formalin to be added up with the fish is that it keeps the fish fresh for a longer time, and they have been either injected or they have either been dipped into the solution. So there are almost like 11 out of 30 samples of the fish species which is being purchased from Chintadripat and the Kasimedu, the two major fish markets in Chennai, on two different days have tested positive for formalin, a cancer-inducing chemical used illegally to preserve the fish. So why the issues become so important is because the formalin, which is actually used to preserve the fish for a longer time, is actually a carcinogen, which means that they are the one which has a cancer-inducing chemicals in them. So if it has been used for the preservation of the fish, which means that there would be a danger for the humanities in nature and for also the surrounding environment would be damaged with respect to the formalin. So we have this carcinogen that is used widely as a preservative and also with a disinfectant, as we just read about it. And for the first time, the samples of the fish in Tamil Nadu have tested positive for formalin. The Food Safety and Standard Authority of India, the officials have undertaken the test at fish markets and harbors across the state to test for formalin following a scare in the neighboring Kerala that the fish shows from here were chemically contaminated. So they're telling that the fish from Kerala has been chemically contaminated, and now the FSSAI has undertaken the test in the fish markets and also in the harbors to understand what would be the effect of formalin on the fish. So we have the fish varieties which was being listed in the newspaper, Hindu newspaper. You don't have to memorize them, it's not important. But let's have a quick recap to it. Risky business, what the test on 30 samples revealed. So we have like 11 samples of the fish tested positive for formalin. We have the 5 samples have high levels of the formalin, that is about 20 parts, that is ppm. Then we have the 6 samples had mild levels of the formalin. And what happens and what are the particular fishes which has been affected by it? It is these affected varieties fishes. We have the amaret shark, then we have the catfish, kettlefish and also the octopus. Then we have the big and the small lizard fish, big and small karangit fish. So these are the fishes. But the formalin, if it has been mixed up, it causes an irritation in the eyes, the throat, the skin and stomach. And in long-term exposure, it could actually harm the kidneys, liver and even cause cancer. So this is the issue. For the first time in Tamil Nadu, the fish has been tested of formalin. So this is about it. The next we have, the work to make Sabarimala Swachh iconic place begins. So we have the district administrator has started the preliminary preparations for converting the Sabarimala into the Swachh iconic place as a part of the Swachh Bharat mission of the Union Government. And the project has envisaged the development of basic facilities at Sabarimala in an economic friendly manner so as to make the pilgrim center clean and also hygienic. The Union Ministry of the Drinking Water and Sanitation is implementing the agency of the project in 100 major places across the country. So you have to know very importantly which is a ministry which is undertaking the project. It is Drinking Water and Sanitation. But right now there's a work which has been started to make Sabarimala a Swachh iconic place, which has already begun by the district magistrate. The preliminary preparations has been started. The next one we have, here what you have to do is you have to understand what are the places of Swachh iconic mission, and you should also know what are the Swachh Bharat mission is all about. So what is Swachh Bharat mission and what is the connection of Swachh iconic place? So for the beginners, you have to look on to these important points. The next one, Arunachal stares at the water scarcity. So here it is, Arunachal Pradesh as starting a scarcity of water, where the source of that has been expected to make a frontier state is India's hydroelectric powerhouse. So the idea was that we wanted to make Arunachal Pradesh as an hydroelectric powerhouse, but right now it's going under the scarcity of water. And the State Minister for Environment and the Forest said that there are more than 200 rivers and the streams across Arunachal Pradesh have dried up. It's almost like 200 rivers and the streams has been dried up. This he felt would soon make a state face shortages. By having a proper dry up with these particular rivers, he is also feeling that this might make the state to face a shortage very shortly. The scenario he indicated could be as grim as Simla, the capital of another presumably water abundant Himalayan state that underwent a severe water crisis recently. So he also gave a connection with Shimla, which recently became a water scarcity city. And we have Mr. Rebia attributed the drying up of water bodies to rampant destructions of forests besides thinning the glaciers in the eastern Himalayas due to climate change. So these are the main ideas telling that deforestation is being taking place and thinning of the glaciers in the Himalayan due to the climate change is the reason for the above situations to occur. And side by sure, we should also know what is the state forest cover. The state forest covers has decreased from 82% to 79%, and the catchment area of many of the rivers are under the threat because of the jhum cultivation, that is slash and burn cultivation and landslides. And you also added that the state government should ban hunting of wildlife. Basically, they hunt the animals for the food and the adornment out here, and they're telling that the jhum cultivation very important is a reason for the state forest cover to have a decline. So that we had a decrease from 82% to 79%, and the water scarcity has undermined the state much wanted hydropower potential, which the Parliament Standing Committee on Energy said 25,962 megawatt, but only about 405 megawatt has been commissioned till 2017. So as I told you, it has to be India's hydroelectric powerhouse, but right now even Arunachal Pradesh is running short of waters, which means that the aim to make it as a powerhouse might have an hit. So these are the important part. So the next one, two BJP ruled state resists the health plan. So this is with respect to the Narendra Modi government ambitious plan, that is a scheme, we call it as Ayushman Bharat, National Health Protection Scheme. The two of the BJP ruled states, that is Rajasthan and Maharashtra, have expressed the reluctance to implement the program. So here we have Narendra Modi's government coming up with an Ayushman Bharat, which is a very ambitious project of the particular government, and the two BJP ruled states, that's Rajasthan and Maharashtra, implement the program. So why is this even happening is because the official said that the Rajasthan government had welcomed the center scheme. They are not sure how to implement it. So they are very clear to what they are saying. They are happy with the scheme to what has been coming forth from the central government, but they are not aware how to implement it. So why they even have this dilemma? Because they are having an ongoing particular scheme or a yojana which is there. And the scheme is Bamasha Swasya Bima Yojana, which is an cashless healthcare services which has been provided to around 4.5 crore people. And moreover, the contract with the insurance company is still next year. It's still the next year. So they are thinking of finding a way to converge the two schemes so that the ongoing scheme is not disturbed. And so this is because the state government, they had one sort of a scheme which is as similar to the Ayushman Bharat, and the central government has also given the same scheme. But they are not aware how do I go about with this particular schemes. And that is a confusion what has been coming from the Rajasthan government. The next one we have is the Maharashtra government, and this cited a lack of funds. But in case of Maharashtra, it's telling that it doesn't have a sufficient funds as a reason for not implementing the scheme. The state government had already runs the scheme called Mahatma Jyotiba Phule Jan Arogya Yojana. It's a flagship health insurance scheme under which 2.2 crore people are provided to cover up to 2 lakh rupees. So here again, Maharashtra government is telling it has an ongoing project. But apart from that, to implement this project, we don't have a sufficient funds. And they gave in relevance to what kind of a project is being done. And Odisha has already refused to implement the center's flagship health program, saying that already it has a Biju Swasthya Kalyan Yojana with more beneficiaries compared to Ayushman Bharat. We have the other two states, that is Punjab and Delhi, are yet to come on board and give their approval on the ABNHPS. And however, despite the disagreements, the West Bengal government has agreed to adopt the scheme, and this is one of the officials that made the statement. And we have so far the states which has implemented is 25 states, and UTs have signed an MOU with the health ministry for implementing the scheme. Meanwhile, we have the National Health Agency, the apex body for implementing of the Ayushman Bharat, has launched a formal process to empanel the public and also the private hospitals to achieve the universal health coverage. And the Modi government is very eager to roll out the schemes across India on August 15th. So these are the different outcomes of the particular schemes, that is Ayushman Bharat. And you have to know that the National Health Agency, which is an apex body for implementing the Ayushman Bharat, the National Health Protection Scheme, and they're just having a formal process how is that they can go ahead and have a kind of an empowering the public and the private hospitals. But the Modi government is very serious about it, and it wants to roll out the scheme by August 15, despite of the other movements which has been coming from the different states. The next news item, 6 bids to supply 110 fighters for IAF, that's Indian Air Force. So we have the 6 global aircraft manufacturers have responded to a request for information. So which means that request for information, that is RFI, from the Indian Air Force to supply 110 fighter aircraft. A deadline for RFI was on July 6th. And all the 6 manufacturers, they have earlierly made a bid for the medium multi-role combat aircraft, which was cancelled in the year 2015. But the officials have confirmed that these 6 bids have been received, of which the Lockheed Martin F-16, and we have the Gripen are the single engine fighters, and we have the F-18, the Dassault Rafale, then we have the Eurofighter, which is, and also the United Aircraft Corporation MiG-35 are twin engine ones. The above 2 are single engine, the rest 4 are the twin engine ones. And the bids have actually been evaluated, after which the IAF will issue the request for proposal. So they would be actually coming up with a particular evaluation once the request for the proposal is being with the exact specification of the aircraft to be procured, and the RFP is expected by early next year. And the RFI issued on April 6th, and it states that the government plans to buy 110 fighters jets, of which 85% will have to be built in India under the Make in India program in partnership with the strategic partner and the Indian production agencies. So this is like 85% of it has to be built in India, because we have a program called Make in India program, and this has to come with a partnership with the strategic partner, the Indian production agency. The next one, the procurement will be processed through the strategic partnership model under the difference procurement procedure. However, SP model itself needs some clarification, which could delay the process. So again, these are a kind of a procurement delays to what might happen and what not. And we have the earlier that the IAF, that is the Indian Air Force, was looking for a single engine jet to replace the MiG-21 and MiG-27 being phased out of service, but RFI did not specify it, opening up the contest to both single and the engine jets. And also the official made a statement that both the configurations were equally competent, and the final choice would depend on the price and extent of the technology transfer. Sorry. And we have informal estimates telling that the entire cost would be a worth of $115 billion, and a single engine aircraft will cost lower than 2 engine jets, both in unit and the operational cost. So this is obvious, a single engine aircraft will actually cost lower when compared to the 2 engine jets. And we have the move comes almost two decades after the Indian Air Force began the last major effort to acquire the fighter in the large numbers. And we have the effort which has been culminated in the global tender for 126 fighters under the MMRCA deal, which was cancelled in the year 2015. We know 2017 was filled up only with these particular items of news. And after that, the Modi government decided to buy 36 fighters from France under the government-to-government deal. So this is connection to the last year's news current affairs part. So this is about the basic part. And we have the center plans stronger defense for key data. The senior ministry official said earlier the files were locked in a cupboard and accountability could be fixed, but with an advent of digital India, there was an ambiguity over a number of issues. So here again, they're dating back to those days where if they want to have a file to be locked up, they used to keep it in a cupboard and the things used to be safer. But just because we are moving and getting advanced with the digital India, there's number of problems which has been occurring, and also the ambiguity how to deal up with a particular file and how to safeguard them. So the particular things which has been worried about the sensitive information making its way to the internet, and also the Home Ministry is upgrading the policy to ensure the government data and control the access to it. So the Home Ministry, Rajnath Singh, directed that the National Information Security Policy and the guidelines be upgraded and updated for government sector. So Mr. Rajnath Singh, the Home Minister, has actually directed that NISPG to be upgraded and also have an updated for the government sector. And in the year 2013, the cyber security, which was a sole preserve of the Home Ministry, was moved to the National Security Council Secretary under the Prime Minister's office, wherein the critical infrastructure was moved to the National Technical Research Organization and a non-critical part of the things to the Ministry of Electronics and the Information Technology. And these are the basic part. So they're just concerned about the data as to how to safeguard them. And here you have the strengthening critical infrastructure. It's basically, it's a national information security policy and guidelines. You have the practices and what has to be done. The next one, Malaysian PM meets Zakir Naik. So here we have the Malaysian Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad, who met a controversial Muslim preacher, and his name is Zakir Naik, and who is wanted in India for alleging, and he is a wanted person in India for terror activities and also monitoring issues. So here the meeting, which may not go do well in the particular New Delhi, and it had come up with a message or a clear indication that the Malaysian government would not deport Naik. So why are they saying it will not deport Naik? For various reasons. But we had one particular party which had actually defended the decision. So we have a strategist of Malaysian ruling party PPBM as defender Mr. Mahmud's decision, saying doing so would be akin to deporting the Uyghur Muslims to China. So there was one person called Rais Hussein, is a party ruling party member of PPBM, and he referred it to China, pressing that China is giving a press to Malaysia for extradition of the 11 Muslim men who entered the Malaysia illegally in the year 2017, and they are the one who have been escaped from the jail in Thailand. He said the personnel could see no wrong in Naik's activities and also with his speeches. So he's trying to pull out China and telling that China is also pressing for so-and-so reasons. But he tells that to whatever Mr. The President, the Prime Minister has made a statement, he's not finding any wrong in it to what he has made with respect to Naik. And the Naik's retractor, and he also makes a statement, that is Rais Hussein, also makes a statement. Instead of the mob mentality, you should debate with him rather than asking for him to be deported to India. So this is one of kind of in statements to what he has made in between India and the Malaysian government when they had a problem with respect to the Naik, this person. And he also questioned the motives of Indian authorities whose action he said might not be a grounded injustice. So he also talks about the motives about the Indian authorities, what is it up to. And he's just trying to justify the statements to what the Prime Minister of Malaysia has actually made. That's it. So this is just a grim offer, nothing to do in detail. The next news item, India denies a shifting pillar along Myanmar border. So actually, India has not shifted the pillars demarcating the international border with Myanmar, the External Affairs Ministry. So here, what happened here is that there was a demarcation of the international border between Myanmar and India, and few medias have said that India has given up with few part of India to Myanmar, and the external minister is telling that it is completely to whatever the statements is being coming from the medias, it's not the true statements, and he also call it as baseless and also unsubstantiated. So there's nothing to be called as we have already given, this completely baseless statement. And the statement is coming from the media reports telling that India had given up the land to Myanmar while carrying out a survey. So this was one of an statement which was made by the media. And we have come across media experts stating that the certain boundary pillars in the Manipur sector of the Indian-Myanmar international border have been allegedly shifted. So this is what they meant. And the bilateral border surveys were conducted in keeping with the Indian-Myanmar boundary agreement in 1967. So this is on the light of the agreement in 1967 to what India and Myanmar had done. Taking this into that, the bilateral border kind of an demarcating of the international border happened. But it doesn't mean that we have given up a part of the line or a part of it to the Myanmar country. And the survey done with the objective of appraising the local residents on both the sides of the border of the exact alignment of the international boundary. So this is again to whatever the surveys have made it, they have made it exactly. And the objective of appraising this kind of an issue is because of the local residents on both the sides of the border and also to have an exact alignment. This was a main motive. And we haven't given up with any of the land area to Myanmar. So this is again, External Affairs Ministry is giving up with the statements on it. That's about it. And next we have life at the end of the tunnel. So here we have the issue which is completely, repeatedly been in the newspapers. So here we have the authorities began on Sunday on operation of the 12, to rescue the 12 boys and their football coach from the flooded cave. So you have the complete timeline to what had happened, from when, what is the rescue period which has been taken place right now. You can have a look onto it. Not important, but if you have a look onto it, you might have a specification to what it is. The next one, the government taps RBI to track all transactions. So here, this is a move which has been aimed at widening the crackdown on the black money and following the money trail flowing in and out of the thousands of the shell companies. And the center is planning to set up an IT, that's information technology based mechanism, to keep a tab on all non-cash financial transactions in the country. And high-placed government sources involved in devising the initiative said that the RBI had been asked to develop the IT infrastructure for this particular purposes. So this is basically to have a crackdown into the black money and also for the money laundering which is happening with respect to the shell companies. And taking this into consideration, the center wants to have set up an information technology so that it can deal with the non-cash financial transactions in the country with the proper mechanisms. So here we have the RBI as a sole repository, which means that after a series of discussion, the idea now is to make the RBI the sole repository of such information, which not be made available to other agencies. So what the information is being given to RBI, RBI would be a sole repository to it, and other information would not be available to the agencies of the Income Tax Department as well as the ED, that's the Enforcement Directorate. Such agencies may be required to make the specific request to the central bank if they want the information on a particular set of entities. So under the Prevention of Money Laundering Act, the banks and the financial institutions are already required to alert the Financial Intelligence Unit. So you're under the Money Laundering Act, basically the bank and the financial institutions have to alert the Financial Intelligence Unit, so under the, which is under the Ministry of Finance, and for any suspicion transactions, cash or otherwise. And the cash transactions of more than rupees 10 lakh, which means that they have to definitely be reported to Financial Intelligence Unit, and all suspicion transactions need to be reported to the unit within 7 days. And they have to ensure that the reporting part to the unit has to happen within 7 days. And after that, concluded that the suspicion, what kind of a suspicion is that in nature? And the move to track all the financial transaction is the latest in a series to curb the black money and also identify the shell companies. So this is the latest move which has come. And the following the year 2016's demonetization, there would be almost rendered with 86% of this currency in circulation invalid. And it was a spurt in the operations of the shell firms that typically have no assets or active businesses. So this is like those companies which didn't have any assets or active businesses, but they still have the money which has been evolving around them. So that's the reason they're trying to have a crackdown, or they feel that there is a money laundering or a money supply which is happening through these particular shell companies. So this is about it. The next news item. Telecom firms oppose a tri-public Wi-Fi model. So here we have the telecom operators have opposed the public Wi-Fi model recommended by the sector regulatory, that's a tri, saying it to adversely impact the debt-ridden industries and also compromise on the national security. So this is basically the opposition which is coming from the sector regulator, that is tri, telling that whatever the ideas to what you have as a Wi-Fi model which has been recommended would definitely not be a good idea because of it might have an debt on it and also an national security which would be compromised otherwise. And based on the existing rules for cyber cafes, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India had recommended a new set of players to be called the Public Data Office Aggregators, that is PDOA, should be allowed to resell the internet services through exterior PCO type to set up that will be called as in public data offices. This is a new kind of recommendations which has been put forth, and the proposal to sell the internet services without a license and will be a complete bypass for the present licensing framework and also detrimental to massive investments already made in the spectrum. And this is about the telecom structures to what Mr. Matthew has said. And the report also said proliferation of the public Wi-Fi can provide $3 billion potential revenue. opportunity for the telecom operators between the year 2017 and 2019, and it will help adding a new customers and increasing the data consumption by the existing users. So though we are talking about the national security or the debt which might be hit, which has been suggested, but there are few particular reports which are stating that the public Wi-Fi can actually give a revenue turnover of almost like 3 billion, and also there would be an addition of new customers and also increase in the data consumption by the existing customers. This is our this is another important issue which has been come up. Then we have the users' interest. So there was one particular study which has been done by the analysis Manson, which has been commissioned by the Google, and they found that the significant transaction of the users saying they would be interested in purchasing a new mobile broadband SIM card to continue accessing a high-speed internet after having an experienced high-speed internet through the high-speed Wi-Fi services from the Google. So this is one of the surveys which has been taken, and here the particular customers have been making the statement that they're always welcome purchasing a new mobile broadband SIM card so that they can move on for a high-speed internet services. So that's about it. And the next news item, get to know currency derivatives. So this is basically currency derivatives are considered to be one of the best option to manage any of the risk against a foreign currency exchange rate. So this is with respect to how well is that we can use the best option to manage the risk from the foreign currency exchange, and that's about the currency derivatives. And the currency derivatives are exchange based futures and option contracts that allow one to hedge against a currency movement. Simply put, one can use a currency future contract to exchange one currency for another at a future date at a price decided on the day of the purchase of the contract. The time you try to purchase a contract on that particular day, you would have put forth the future contract to exchange the currencies on the other future date. So this is about the particular derivatives. And in India, one can use such derivative contracts to hedge against the currencies like the dollar, euro, UK, pound and yen. And the corporates, especially those with a significant exposure to imports or imports, use these contracts to hedge against their exposure to certain currencies. Basically, this would come in more in help with the exposures of the imports and the exporters. So while all such currencies contracts are cash settled in rupees, and the Securities and the Exchange Board of India, we call it as SEBI, early in the year 2018 have a go ahead to start across the currency contracts as well as the euro dollar, pound dollar and the dollar yen. And the two national stock exchanges, one is the Bombay Stock Exchange and National Stock Exchange, have currency derivative segments. So we have it in the stock exchanges of India, and the Metropolitan Stock Exchange of India has also had such a segment, but the volumes are a fraction of that witnessed on the BSE or the NSE, but one can trade through the brokers. So this is with respect to how is the segment volumes are really working. So here it can be traded through the brokers. Incidentally, all the leading stock brokers offer the currency trading services too. They also give up the trading services, and it is just like trading in equity and also the equity derivative segments, and can be done through the app of the broker. So why is this particular derivatives introduced on the exchange platform? Because earlier it used to be called as an over-the-counter OTC, the market to hedge the currency risk, and where the forward contracts were negotiated and entered into. But it was a kind of an closed market where mostly the banks and financial institutions used to get traded. By introducing this particular derivatives, you have proper opportunities to what has to be done with the risk pertaining to the foreign exchange. And are these derivatives popular? The currency derivative segments was unveiled in the year 2008, and since then the volumes had registered a steady rise. They're telling that it is quite a most popular one, and from the time we have introduced in the year 2008, it is having a good steady rise. So this is about the derivatives. You'll not understand at one go to what is derivatives. Not to worry about it, just keep reading to what has been placed here as a points, so that if you read twice or thrice, you'll get to know what is a point is all about. So this is one of the thing which was there in the Hindu newspaper. If you are a beginner, this might help you in trading. So these were the important news items for 9/7/2018. Thank you.